evening. Welcome, welcome again to another of our Wednesday evening prayer and praise session. We are grateful that you are spending time with us again, and we thank you for joining us. Those who are joining on YouTube, we welcome you. And those who are joining on Facebook, we welcome you as well. By way of quick reminder, you have tuned in to FWP Center, and on behalf of Pastor Sean Dowding and all the pastoral team, we want to just say thanks for joining with us from the First Seventh-day Adventist Church of White Plains. Now, I am Adrian Alvaranga, and beside me is my wife,
Georgia Alvaranga.
And again, we are grateful that you are here with us. So just by a quick way of rundown how the program works, in case it's your very first time, as we pray and praise, we want to hear from you if you have any prayer requests or if you have a praise report. And what we do is we invite you to just communicate, use the chat feature in Facebook or use the comments section in YouTube, and just put in if you have any prayer requests. And at the time when we do the intercessory prayer, we will incorporate those prayer requests. So, you know, feel free to get acquainted with that section of YouTube or that section of the Facebook chat. Again, we thank you. I'm going to invite you to just bow your heads with me. We will open with a word of prayer. And then after the word of prayer, we will have a wonderful song of music as an opening song. And then I will get back to let you know how the rest of the program will go. So just bow your heads with me as we pray at this time.
Loving Lord, we want to thank you so much for your protection over our lives. We want to thank you for being with us thus far throughout the week, for taking us. We're now in the middle and we still have a few more days to go. We pray that you will continue to keep us safe from all harm and danger, and help us that we will do your will, O God. Be with all of us who are present here now, and be with those who will be coming on to join and see. We pray that you will bless each member of our church. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Circumstances or things I could not understand. Many times in trials, weakness blurs my vision, then my frustration gets so out of hand. But instead, I am reminded I've never been forsaken, I've never had to stand one test alone. That's when I look at all the victories, and the spirit rises up in me, and it's through the fire my weakness is made strong. Would not get heavy, and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered more victories without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. Just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision, and the adversary says, give in, or just hold on. Oh, Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again. I know within myself that I would surely perish. Oh, but if I trust the mighty hand of God, he'll shield the flames again. that the cross would not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered all victories without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. Just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision and the adversary says give in, just hold on. Our Lord will show up and he will take you through the fire again. So just hold on. Our Lord will show up and he will take you through the fire again.
Amen, amen, amen. What a lovely, lovely song. And dare I say, what a lovely, lovely singer. God has certainly blessed that young lady with a gift of singing. Don't you think so?
Yes.
Amen. To God be the glory. Great things he has done. Friends, you know, let me make sure that I choose my words carefully, because I don't want anyone to misinterpret anything as a political statement. You know, our church and this platform will never be used to put forth any political statement. But I want to share something that I was reading this morning, and the now former president, in one of his last acts before he left, he issued, nothing new, by the way, other presidents have done this, but he issued pardons and clemency. And for those that are not aware, pardons and clemency are pardons and commutation, are kind of similar, but a little bit different. So a pardon will kind of free you from any future prison sentence or penalty. You know, it frees you from a conviction, whereas a commutation or clemency will not free you, but reduce that sentence. But on the matter of pardons, and as I was reading the article, and I was looking at, persons who were pardoned, it dawned on me that the president, with just a stroke of a pen, could pardon someone. But he pardons someone from something that they have done in this life. And I started to think, and I said, wow, you know, God, Jesus, not through the stroke of a pen, but through the giving of his own life, you know, not with ink, but with blood, offers us a pardon as well. And that pardon, it frees us because he paid the penalty. It takes away the penalty that we should bear. And I wonder to myself, wow, what an amazing gift. It just reminded me how good God is. Well, you know what too? The article that I was reading, it also mentioned, I think years ago, I'm forgetting the year, but I'm pretty sure it's a long time ago, sometime in the 1800s, a president actually pardoned someone, and the person refused the pardon. The person refused the pardon, and guess what happened? They paid the penalty for that wrong. And the penalty was death. The Supreme Court ruled that even though the president had pardoned them, the individual with their own choice had the right to reject the pardon. And so the person was executed because they rejected the pardon. And stay with me, stay with me. This is not a political statement. It dawned on me even further. Friends, God has given us a pardon. We cannot reject it. We cannot refuse it. Please don't refuse it. And so, as we would do today, one of the first things I want to ask Ella Watson, who would do the intercessory prayer for us, is that he would pray for every single person that watched this program, that they would recognize that there's a pardon on the table offered for them, and that through the grace of God, they would not reject that pardon. Because if we do, like that man that was executed, we will have to bear the penalty ourselves. So let us ensure that we do not reject that. I also want to, continue to ask for prayer for our country at large. We, I guess, in some ways, and to use the words of some persons, we are transitioning into, I guess, a new chapter. And we just want to pray that God will continue to guide and guide our leaders and guide this country. And guide us as individuals, because friends, we as citizens of this country, and for those who are, viewing from a wider audience, citizens of this world, we have a part to play. We need to exercise and exemplify love for each other. We have to move past, fighting against each other and tearing down each other. So I want to ask, Ella Watson, that as he prays for our nation, that he also prays for the citizens of our nations and the citizens of the world, that we will again reconnect, learning how to be loving, learning how to be compassionate, learning how to be caring, learning how to look out for each other. We can disagree, but we don't have to be mean and cruel towards each other. We want to continue prayer for, the pandemic that we're going through. Pray that, God will continue to heal this land. Persons are still suffering. It is hard. We're hearing the death toll, the numbers that are dying each day. I don't know about you, but it's depressing even. It's just so hard, overwhelming at times, to just hear that. So we want to pray. We never get discouraged. We know that God is on the case. So we want to continue to lift him up. We also want to pray for those who are sick, those who are not doing so well. Friends are always encouraged that, you take up the phone and reach out to our fellow church members, our brothers and our sisters, reach out to them. So I ask Elder Watson that he will lift up those who are not doing well, are ill, those who need the balm in Gilead at this time. Elder Housen still comes to mind, but there are others. The Peart family comes to mind, but there are others. So we pray for them as well. We also pray that God will continue to be with our dear pastor and be with, mission within our church. Help us, to continue to, as Christ himself says, go preach, teach, baptize in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son. So we want to continue to pray that God will be with the mission work of his church and help us not to get weary in well-doing.
Pray for our family, our church family members who may be unemployed or seeking a job, and all those other persons who are unemployed as well. And in this trying and hard time, maybe seeking a job, and probably the jobs are not available. Yes, so pray for those persons as well.
Amen. All right, so we're going to come up to now where we're going to have our prayer. I'm going to invite my wife to do a prayer song. And then immediately after the prayer song, I turn over to Ella Watson to lead us into that intercessory prayer.
Into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart, Lord Jesus, come in today, come in to stay, come in to my heart, Lord Jesus, come in today, come in, I pray, come in to my heart, Lord Jesus.
Amen. I just want to take this opportunity for those who are watching, those who are listening. I know this time has been a difficult time. For many people, it has been a challenging time. But I stopped to remind somebody this afternoon that God is on your side. It might appear that you are on your own, but brothers and sisters, visitors, you're never alone. In spite of the COVID-19, in spite of the political and economic conditions, oftentimes we feel despair, sad, forsaken. I want to remind you this afternoon that you are not alone. God loves you too much. A matter of fact, he has emptied heaven, came to this earth so that you can have the assurance, Emmanuel, God with us. So let us pray with the confidence that we have a God on our side. Loving God and our Father, it is with grateful hearts that we come before your presence. We recognize that it's not because of any good thing we have done why we are here, but it's always because of your goodness and your mercies towards us, your children. We come with a heart of gratitude, recognizing had it not been for the Lord on our side tonight, where would we be? We come, just want to say thank you, Lord, for just being our present help in these times of trouble. Thanking you for being our bridge over these troubled waters. We want to thank you for being such a faithful God. In spite of our challenges, you are aggressively seeking to save that which was lost. You are indeed the good shepherd, willing to lay down your life, but not only willing, but lay down your life. So like sheep, we can have the assurance of salvation. We have come tonight because the truth be told, Lord, we have not lived as we ought to live. We have not served you as we ought to. And Lord, we come tonight confessing our sins. You told us in your words that if we confess our sins, that you are indeed faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse. We ask for a cleansing tonight from the crown of our head, Father, to the sole of our feet. We ask, God, having cleansed us, that you will recreate in us clean hearts, renew right spirit. But not only that, God, we ask like day of Pentecost, that your spirit will come down in copious showers, that you will saturate our minds, saturate our being, so that our actions, our thoughts, our impulses will be motivated by heaven. Tonight, God, we come fully cognizant of the fact that we're living in a sinful world And the enemy of our souls is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. But we are also confident that the lion of the tribe of Judah prevails. And so, God, we come tonight, want to present those in government. We are at a juncture, a critical juncture. The passing on of the baton, if you please. A new leadership. Pray, God, for your divine intervention, your divine wisdom. I pray for your Holy Spirit to saturate the minds of our leaders. And God, that you will give them wisdom, give them knowledge, give them understanding. Give them an obedient heart, that they will listen to the prompting of your Spirit. And God, that they will lead your people aright. Then, Lord, we pray for the citizens of this country and world over, that you will give us the mind of Christ, that we'll continue to intercede on the behalf of our leaders and on behalf of our fellow citizens. Oh God, may we recognize that we are all created in the very image of God. And of such, God, that we'll treat each other with respect, that we'll seek the good of others. And so in the process, God, that men and women will come to know Christ, who is life eternal. Lord, I want to pray for those who are sick. Many who have been affected and infected by this COVID, this virus. Oh God, we pray even for the bereaved families of those who have lost loved ones. Sympathizing Jesus, the man of sorrow, unacquainted with our griefs. We pray tonight, God, that you will draw close to those who are bereaved at this time, that you will speak words of hope. Remind them, God, that death is not the end for the Christian. A matter of fact, you said those who die in Christ are just sleeping, waiting for the voice of the Lord to call them. Help them, oh God, to rest in the loving arms of Jesus with the assurance, God, that you promised that you will never leave your people nor forsake them. For those who are sick, we ask that you be the healer, be the balm in Gilead, God. We pray for Sister Peart and the Peart family even this time. Lord, you know them by name and nature. You know them intimately. We ask that you will continue the work you have started of healing and restoration. Bring her back to full physical and mental and social health. Lord, that she will have a testimony of what God can do. We pray for Elder Housen too, Father, who has been struggling. But we are reminded that there is no sorrow, there is no difficulty that God cannot heal, no problem that God cannot solve, no sickness that God cannot heal. And so, God, we ask that you'll do for him that which we cannot do. Then, Lord, I pray for those who are unemployed. Oh, Lord, this has been a difficult year for so many. So many have lost their jobs. So many are unable to secure gainful employment. But God, we are reminded that your promise that our bread and water will be sure. We promise, God, that there is no deficiency in your resources in heaven. And so, God, we ask that you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that they may not have room enough to receive. Then, Lord, I pray for this church as we seek to advance the kingdom of Christ. We ask for your divine blessing. We ask for your divine unction so that we can function in such a way that will bring honor and glory to your name, and that men and women will be drawn closer to you. We pray for our pastor. And for the pastoral team, we pray for our pastor and his family. We ask God that you will continue to bless them, that keep them secure. Send an angel of excelling strength to be by their side. Then, Lord, we pray for church membership and a whole. Lord, bind us together with a cause of love that cannot be broken. Let us recognize, God, that the golden morning is fast approaching, and soon Jesus will come to take his children home. Lord, like Paul, may we say nothing will be able to separate us. No COVID, no unemployment, no political unrest, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of Christ. And tonight, Lord, we want to remember the person, Pastor Richardson, that you have chosen to break the bread of life. Heavenly Father, I ask that you will speak through him a word that will help us to recognize the sacrifice that you have made on Calvary's cross, that we will accept the pardon that you have given, that you laid down your life, Father. May we accept their sacrifice so that we will not have to pay the debt, but we will rise to walk in newness of life. Use us, use it mightily for your cause and for your kingdom. And Lord, when we shall have come to this end of the service, may we be energized, revitalized. May we be empowered to be your witnesses to the world. This is our prayer. In no other name but the precious and the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Let God's people say amen and amen.
Amen, amen, amen. So we've come to that point in our program where we hear a word from God spoken through his manservant. And tonight, as Ella Watson mentioned, we will hear from Pastor Ivor Richardson. Pastor Richardson has been called to ministry even from a very early age. I was impressed by his testimony, I think months back when I listened to him. And he has been serving the Lord faithfully. God has empowered him, and he has been faithfully following the footsteps of Jesus wheresoever they lead. And I'm very proud and impressed with that. Before Pastor Richardson speaks a word that God has given to him, to us, we will have a song of meditation, after which the next voice you will hear will be that of Pastor Richardson.
They bound the hands of Jesus in the garden where he prayed. They led him through the streets in shame. They spat upon the Savior, so pure and free from sin. They said, "Crucify him, he's to blame." He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. Yes, upon his precious head they placed a crown of thorns. They laughed and said, "Behold the King." They struck him and they cursed him, and they mocked his holy name. All alone he suffered everything. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. but he died alone for you and me. He died alone for you and me.
Good evening, my Christian friends. I'm delighted to be with you in this prayer session. I pray that God is blessing you mightily tonight. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being faithful. You know, prayer meetings don't gather much in terms of attendance. It's said that the diehards are the very faithful are the ones that attend. And so if you're attending, I know that you're faithful. May God continue to bless you. Before I speak on my topic tonight, I've asked some of the elders to help me read a few portions of scripture. I'm going to start with Elder Watson with Judges 7, 1 to 7. For those who like to follow at home, it's Judges chapter 7, verses 1 to 7.
Amen. Yeah, Judges 7, 1 to 7, I read. Then Zerubbabel, who is Gideon, and all the people that were with him, rose up early and pitched beside the well of Herod, so that the host of the Midianites were on the north side of them, by the hill of Moreh in the valley. And verse 2 said, the Lord said unto Gideon, the people that are with thee are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel vaunt themselves against me. Lest Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, mine own hand had saved me. Now therefore go, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whosoever is fearful and afraid, let them return and depart early from Mount Gilead. And there return of the people 22,000, and there remain 10,000. And the Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too many. Bring them down to the water, and I will try them for thee there. And it shall be that of whom I say unto thee, this shall go with thee, the same shall go with thee. And of whomsoever I say unto thee, this shall not go with thee, the same shall not go. And verse 5 says, so he brought down the people unto the water. And the Lord said unto Gideon, everyone that lappeth at the water with his tongue, and as a dog lappeth, him shall thou set by himself. Likewise, everyone that boweth down upon his knee to drink, and the number of them that lapped and put in their hand to their mouth were 300 men. But all the rest of the people bowed down on their knees to drink water. And verse 7 says, and last, and the Lord said unto Gideon, by the 300 men that lapped will I save you and deliver the Midianites into thine hand. And let all the other people go, every man unto his place. Hear it, the reading of God's holy word.
Thank you, Elder Watson. And Elder Alvin Wanger is going to read Matthew chapter 10. For those who want to follow at home, Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 to 4.
Reading from the King James Version, it says this, and when he had called unto him 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out, and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these. The first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Lebeus, whose surname is Thaddeus. Verse 4 and last, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him.
Thank you, Elder Alvaranga. And our esteemed pastor, senior pastor, Dr. Dowling, is going to read our final portion of scripture. It comes from Luke chapter 10, verses 1 to 12. Luke 10, 1 to 12.
After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or a bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say peace to this house. If someone promotes peace there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and you are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe away from our feet as a warning to you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near." Verse 12 and last, "I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town."
Thank you, elders and pastor. God has laid in my heart a message, really sermonette. God is looking for a few good men. I use men here in the generic term, meaning men and women, not in terms of gender, meaning masculine. It means men and women. God is looking for men and women. He's looking for a few good ones. Let us pray. God, we pause for this sermonic prayer of this sermonette that, Lord, you will humble our hearts. Quiet our spirits, O God. Help us to meditate for a few minutes on your word. May we be able to glean something from that word so we can say like the psalmist David, "Thy word I've hid in my heart that I might not sin against God." Lord, we need to learn our word and really embrace it, write in our minds, hide in our hearts, recite in our lips, Lord, so that it can teach us, instruct us, and lead us into wisdom. I pray, Lord, that you will help us to be people who have teachable spirits, because we're not willing to be taught, we can't teach anyone. If we're not be willing to led by your Holy Spirit, oh God, we can't lead anyone. And so we open up ourselves to you, Lord. We put our problems at the foot of your cross. If we're smart, we'll leave it there. But some of us are stubborn, oh God, we'll take it up and struggle with it. But we should know that only you, and you better than anyone, knows how to address our problems. Inspire us, Lord. Clear our minds, illuminate our understanding, that we may grow in grace and knowledge of Jesus. This we ask in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. God is looking for a few good men and women. In Judges, Gideon was asked to amass a mighty army. His task was to be able to get the Midianites into his hands, or to defeat the Midianites. And so the Midianites were a powerful force. And of course, Gideon assessed an army of 22,000. But this was a request from God. And see, God isn't like us. We think that there is might in numbers. We believe that you have to have massive numbers for something to be worthwhile. But no, God says, no, 22,000 is too much for me. And so Gideon would whittle that army down to 10,000. And God says, 10,000 is still too much for me. And see, what Gideon didn't understand, when we amass something from a human perspective, it looks mighty, it looks strong. But see, we amass all sort of people. Some of the people that 22,000 are full of sin and no good to God. And so God is looking for those who are faithful, those who are committed, those who are prayer warriors, those who have faith, those he can trust to carry the fight out. And so God was willing to fight on the side of Gideon, but he needed to get that number down to a godly number. See, a little in the hand of God yields mighty results. See, we don't understand what's impossible for men is possible for God. And so God will ask him to take him down to the water, and he would ask him to check and see how they drink the water. And of course, as you read the scripture, those who drank it correctly were put on one side, but those who drank incorrectly put it on the other side. And the number was whittled down to 3. And with 300 men, God was able to conquer the Midianites, because the principle of holiness, the principle of grace, the principle of true power, the principle of true love and might is in Christ. See, scripture tells us that Christ and Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit are full of grace and truth. And so God whittled down that army to a few men where he could accomplish his purpose. You know, next scripture in Matthew, Christ is commissioning the disciples. See, Christ had come to earth at age 12. He would go into the temple and read from Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel, to bind up the brokenhearted, to lead the captives, and to declare the favorable year of the Lord." And so what Christ said to the disciples, "Look, I know you think I'm a powerful teacher, and I am. And I've been teaching you so long, it's time for you to stop being a student, and I'm going to commission you." See, you can't learn forever. God says he doesn't respect those who are ever learning but never coming to what? The knowledge of the truth. And so he was saying to the disciples, "With all the teaching I've given, it's time that you come to the knowledge of the truth. You're no longer disciples or students. You're now apostles, because I'm going to commission you. And I know that I'm sending you out into a world of wolves where there's trouble in every hand." It was a world much like ours: conflict, political turmoil, disease, pandemics, everything that we're experiencing now, they were experiencing back then. But God said, "Look, I'm going to send you out. Don't take any money. Don't take any cloak. Don't even take any shoes. And don't worry, because my Spirit is going to go before you and what? Prepare the way." Notice that God only chose 12 men. 12 men in terms of the society he was sending them out into is a few. God chose a few good men. And even though God whittled down the number to 12, or only chose 12, I should say, notice in that 12 was what? What we call a fly in the ointment, a traitor, Judas Iscariot. And so just like Gideon, who had many traitors and many weak links in his army, God would have to whittle it down to 3. God chose only 12, but in the midst was one that would yield to the devil. But God would use these 11 to profoundly change the world. They were to heal the sick, dispossess demons for those who were demonic possessed. They were to preach the gospel. They were to tell the people that the kingdom of God has what? Come near to you today. See, the kingdom of God comes near to us, and sometimes we miss the presence of God because we don't sense that we're in God's presence, because we're not always prayed up. We're not always in our scripture. We're not always cognizant that we're in the presence of a holy and righteous God, Jesus Christ. But the disciples understood, and even though they were afraid, they were obedient, because that's what God requires, obedience. And so they went onto the world and profoundly changed the world. Now let's go to our final scripture tonight, which was taken from Luke chapter 10. Verses 1 to 12. And so in Luke, the physician apostle, Luke details for us the commissioning of the 70. God was so successful with the 12 that he would repeat it by commissioning 70 more to help the 12 that were already in the field laboring. And so one of the things that Jesus tells them, he says, look, the harvest of those who need me, the harvest of those who are in sin, the harvest, because I am interested as a holy and righteous God to yield what? A harvest of righteousness. God is trying to yield, make no mistake about it, yield a harvest of righteousness. It's hard to find those who are righteous, but that's what God is looking for. Those who are righteous through accepting Jesus, as we do today. We know that when we accept Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus washes our sins, cleanses us from all unrighteousness, teaches us all wisdom. And so God is looking for those who are not afraid to go out in the mission field or the field of evangelism and reach others for him. And so just as he was effective with the 12, now he's commissioning the 70 because what? There's more work to do. And so 70 is also a small number, if you think about it in terms of the mission field, because he sent them to all parts of the then known world. Much as we, as modern day Christians, try to go out into the world and reach others. It's a scary thing for those who are not prepared. But for those who are prepared, we're not afraid. We understand that the Spirit of God goes before us as it did for the 12, that the Spirit of God prepares the way. The Spirit of God will protect us as we go out to reach others for him. Sometimes you're insulted. Sometimes you're rejected. Sometimes people don't want to hear the gospel, or they say, yeah, take the track and they go, because they don't really understand that what you're telling them is that the kingdom of God has come to you. And so today you can have redemption from your wretched sin. And so a little in the hand of God yields much. God says in that scripture, in the scripture in Luke, pray to the Lord of the harvest. Now, who is the Lord of the harvest? It's Jesus himself. And so Jesus is telling us, pray to him that he himself, of course, with the company of God the Father and God the Holy Spirit, would send out laborers into the harvest, because there is a harvest to reap. And what's true, my Christian brothers and sisters, there still is a harvest that God desires to send out laborers into a field to reach others. And so in this new year, if you want to know what God is saying to you, God is saying, I'm looking for a few good men. I'm looking for a few good women. I'm looking for a few good children who I can trust, who will commit their lives to me, who will be willing to be brave enough to go into the harvest or into the mission field and preach and teach, or share, if you can't preach or teach, the gospel. Because just sharing a verse with a friend has such an impact on them that it can lead them to finding the kingdom of God in their lives. And we know that the world is in confusion. We've just come through a political turmoil. We're in the midst of a difficult pandemic, which has killed many of our loved ones. Has killed some 400,000 people in the United States alone, has killed much more if you total it up around the world, worldwide. And we don't see any evidence of this virus abating. It doesn't seem to be getting less. It seems that every day, some 4,000 people die in the United States and many people die around the world. And we're praying as Christians that God will help us by cleaning up the environment, by sending the snow that can what? Freeze this virus down, because we know when viruses are frozen, they become inactive. And that's one way of freezing and cleaning the environment. Rain also washes out a virus and makes it less. And then if we can get the people cured and stop passing it from each other, one person to another person to person to person, we can get beyond this. But I know that God is in charge. We need not despair. God is still in control in the midst of our difficulties. In the midst of this pandemic, God is still in control. In the midst of the political upheaval, God is still in control in the midst of our crime. God is still in control in the midst of our confusion. God is still in control. God is looking for men, women, and children who he can send out into the field. Men who have faith, men who trust God, men who love God, men who want to serve him, men who and women who want to reach others for his kingdom. And there is a harvest. And Jesus says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. I wonder, my Christian brothers and sisters, can God count on you to be one of the few who are willing to commit to God, be 100% sold out to God, and say, here I am, Lord, send me. I know that the harvest is plentiful. I know the laborers are few, but I'm willing to go. I'm willing to serve you. I'm willing to teach. I'm willing to share the gospel. I'm willing to preach. I'm willing to be used by you. Here I am. Send me. In the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Wow, wow. Thank you so much, Pastor Richardson. What a way God has used you in a mighty, mighty way. Friends, can God depend on you? You know, as Pastor delivering the word, I'm thinking and asking myself that question. Can God depend on me? Are we going to be in that batch of a few good men? And as Pastor, you know, pointed out early, you know, it's not gender, you know, it's mankind, humanity. Are we going to stand on the side of God? Are we going to be in that few number that will be faithful? Give our gifts, give our talent. Don't worry about the masses that refuse to come. That's all right. Let us be faithful. Let God be able to say, you see that man there or that woman there? That person will give me honor, will give me glory. Can God call your name as he called Job? What a word, Pastor Richardson. Thank you so much. Friends, if you have been watching us here and you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, now is the time. Do not put that off for tomorrow. Now is that time. Make sure you reach out to us. Make sure you reach out to us and we will connect with you and we will pray with you. I'm going to invite you now to bow your heads with me as we pray to close this Wednesday evening prayer session. Let us pray. Father in heaven, what a mighty way you have reminded us, dear God, that you have a work for all of us to do, dear Jesus. Father, you have blessed us with many gifts, dear God. And oh God, I know, dear Father, that you desire us to be faithful with those gifts, dear God. Father, you have not given us basket to carry water, dear Jesus, for you are here with us, dear God. Father, you have promised that the harvest is indeed plentiful. It is ripe, dear Jesus. It is us, dear Father. It is we that don't want to go out into the harvest. So forgive us of our sins, dear God. Help us, dear God, to trust in you fully, dear God. May we line up on the side of being one of a few good men and not be a fly in the ointment, dear God. Bless, dear Father, every person that have heard your words spoken through your manservant today. And may they make a decision for you, or may they recommit their life to you at this time, beginning with myself. I ask it in no other name, but in the precious name of Jesus. Let everyone say amen and amen.
Good evening to everyone, and thank you, Pastor Richardson, one more time for that pedagogic way of putting the word forward. Thank you for looking at those texts and reminding us that God is looking for a few good men and women. You know, there was a film called A Few Good Men. it boxed office over 240 million people. And that's just fictive. That's just a story. But the story you just told can lead into eternal life. This is a story of a God who promises life forever. And so we hope that over 240 million will accept this offer of a few good men, God of heaven calling a few good men to come and join him in winning souls and saving lives and in inheriting the kingdom. So thank you, Pastor Richardson, for your way and for God's blessing through you. We want to just remind our members, we come together again on Sabbath. We have our guest speaker with us this Sabbath, and we pray that you will join us. We pray that you'll continue praying for each other, reaching out to each other. And as you know, like Pastor Richardson said, prayer services are very few good people, men, women, and children who tune in live. They watch afterwards. And so we need to spread the word. Let them know that you were blessed each Wednesday night when you come here. When you find something on our channel, send a word to someone, send a link, share it, so they too can be blessed, because God is doing a powerful work through online ministry all across the world. And men and women are coming to Christ through online ministry. And so I know not that little thing that will make someone take the step into the kingdom and hold on to Jesus. So wishing you that task, that you reach out to your friends and family members and to those who are isolated or shut-ins or golden age folks. Reach out, friends and family, coworkers and neighbors, reach out to them and let them know you are there for them and you're praying for them and you're wishing them God's protection and peace in these times. So God bless you, my friends, until we see each other next Sabbath. I pray that you have a wonderful night.